Look at all these words for mother from around the world. Do you notice anything about them? They all start with an M or a M sound, and that is no coincidence. Let's just try something. See if you can tell in which of these clips I am saying the word mama. One more time. It was clip number 3.
Ha ha, la la, mama.
Did you get it? I expect that you did, because you have been able to tell when someone is making a m sound since, well, before you were able to speak yourself. M is one of the very first sounds that babies learn to replicate, and that is why mama is a very common first sound, and indeed is almost certainly why so many mother words begin with an M. Other common first sounds include p for papa, or d for dada, or b for ball. And all of these sounds have something fascinating in common. The way babies, this is not my actual baby, and therefore all of us learn to talk is little short of miraculous. They are little geniuses. And we're learning more about them all of the time, as you're going to find out in this video, because I've been speaking to experts in the field and I am so excited to tell you about it.
They tend to be quite similar, the first words that children say.
This is Professor Julian Pine from the University of Liverpool. He's spent decades researching how kids learn to speak, including what their first words often are.
There's lots of words they could say, but they tend to say mummy and daddy. They tend to have words for objects, which are sort of salient objects, so things like bottle and ball and balloon, rather than things that are just in the background. They often have words like bye-bye and uh-oh for sort of salient sort of events, things that, you know, catch their attention.
Right, babies tend to opt for objects and concepts that they frequently come into contact with. But that isn't all that they're doing. There are plenty of common objects that very rarely end up being a baby's first word. So what's happening with the ones that are?
They tend to often be words with particular sound patterns. So for example, you know, words like bye-bye and ball begin with B, mummy begins with M, but and ma are both sounds that are easy to see when people are making them because they're both said with the lips at the front of the mouth. So it's no coincidence that a lot of English kids' first words begin with m and b, or d, which is not said with the lips, but again, it's at the front of the mouth, sort of with the tongue against the teeth.
The interesting thing that's perhaps happening with mum and dad is that, yes, they are both made at the front of the mouth, but they're made differently with different organs, making them a bit easier for a baby to tell apart. That therefore helps them to create distinctive words for their mother and father, a distinction that is important.
Whereas sounds like k and g are said sort of further back in the mouth, and so they come a little bit later.
You know, I asked subscribers to this channel for what their or their children's first words were, and you can see in the responses how what Julian is saying checks out. It's incredible. When you speak to a baby, they're paying attention not only to the sounds that you're making, but how you're making them. You'll notice them sometimes staring at your mouth, and that's not just because it's moving and that's fun, but because they are learning. And the sounds made at the front of the mouth, like at the lips, are the easiest for them to spot. Words for mother and father in languages all over the world appear to be directly derived from the first sounds that babies are able to make. Indeed, the word baby itself is probably imitative of the babbling noises that a baby makes, meaning that babies named themselves. And I wouldn't put it past them. Babies are little linguistic geniuses. For example, they have an ability that we've long since lost by the time we've reached whatever age you are now. A baby is born capable of learning any language on the planet, no matter how complex or baffling that language might seem to us as adults.
Infants can tell the different sounds between almost all sounds in any human language in the world.
Eylem Altuntas works at the adorable sounding Babylab at Western Sydney University. She can explain this better than I can.
So say English learning babies can tell the difference between L and R. So it's like load and road, but it is relevant in English. But what is interesting is they can also tell the difference between a retroflex and dental T, Hindi contrasts. And these don't exist in English.
Right, so a baby that will go on to speak English and is only ever surrounded by English speakers will nevertheless have no problem differentiating between, for example, the different tones of Mandarin or the different clicks of Hosa. I mean, I almost certainly mispronounced the name of that language there because I don't understand the different clicks of Hosa, but when I was a baby, I could have told them apart, and so could you. Turns out there are lots of things we're capable of as babies that would surprise you. For example, most of us can't remember a single thing from when we were that young. But a recent study by researchers at Yale University suggests that babies are nevertheless forming memories as early as 12 months old. Ground News, who sponsored this video, have brought together over 50 articles on that study alone so that we can get the full story. Ground News is a website and app that provides you with all the information you need to understand the news, such as information on where an outlet's biases lie or how reliable it is. In the case of the Yale study, it ranks all of the sources as high or very high for factuality, meaning you can read the articles with confidence. Ground News also gives you a summary of the key facts from all the articles, like the detail that scientists believe these early experiences significantly contribute to language acquisition and learning. So there you go. I've been working with Ground News for a while now because I think it's never been more important to understand where your news is coming from, where its biases lie, and whether or not it can be trusted. And Ground News gives you all the tools to do that. If you want to get access to that, along with news sources from around the world, go to ground.news/robwords or use my QR code to get 40% off unlimited access to the Vantage plan like I have. That only comes out at, what, $5 a month? Give it a go. So back to what I was saying before about babies being able to differentiate between the sounds of any language on this sweet planet of ours.
Obviously, they've got to be sensitive to all the sounds of all the languages they could be exposed to.
Exactly, Julian. We are not born knowing what language we'll end up speaking, so we've got to be prepared for anything. But what is even more amazing, I think, is that not only can babies tell the differences within languages, but they can tell the differences between languages, and not only from birth, but even earlier. Some research suggests that we might be able to distinguish between languages while still in the womb. That's like minus age. Babies can hear speech from inside their mummy's tummy. It's muffled, but it is enough to hear the rhythms of a language. And this particular study here found that a fetus's heartbeat changed slightly when a speaker switched from American English to Japanese, suggesting that they noticed the change. And once the baby is brought into the world, they suddenly have even more ways to tell one language from another, because not only can they hear more precisely the sounds of the languages, but they can also see how the sounds of the languages are actually being made. And Eylem has just completed some research that challenges our understanding of how early they can do this. What she and her team did was amazing.
Long story short, we created two artificial languages, and each language had 240 made-up words. And just to put it simply, one language has lip words, or one language is spoken using your lips, and the other language is spoken using your tongue tip. A lip word sounds something like b va wo, so I'm using my lips, b va wo. A tongue tip might sound like the za lo, so the z l sounds.
The point of these two fake languages is that they not only sound different, but they look different when they're being spoken, because the sounds of each is being made in different parts of the mouth. Bi va wo, di za lo. And what the team at the Baby Lab wanted to find out was whether or not the babies could tell these languages apart. But the problem is, how do you know if they can? You can't just ask them, is this language A or language B? Well, you can ask them, but you won't get an answer. So this is where Eylem and her team had to be really clever.
It's not that difficult to get an answer from babies if you can create associations in their brains. So basically what we did, we played these words through the speaker and they sat in front of the screen with their moms. So every time they hear a word, it is followed by a cartoon image on the screen. Mini language A, followed by a jellyfish. Mini language B, followed by a crab image. So you do this again and again and again and again. So you create an association in their brains and they expect to see a particular image depending on what word they hear.
But how does this association help us to know whether they can successfully tell these languages apart? Because the baby comes to expect one language to appear with one image and the other with the other image, and something interesting happens when they don't.
You give them the wrong image, you violate the expectation, and we expect a surprise effect. And it's usually the difference in their looking behavior. So they might be looking less or more at the matching pairs, for example. And that's how we see, oh, okay, they have learned these two languages because once it doesn't match, their looking behavior changes.
And sure enough, the babies in Eylem's study could tell when the wrong language was being spoken with the wrong image, i.e. they could tell the languages apart. But get this, and this is for me the really amazing part. They could tell those languages apart without even hearing them.
They didn't hear words in the test phase, but they just saw a female face silently speaking those words.
And they were still able to associate the image with the right language. They were still able to recognize the two mini languages just by looking at the words being spoken.
Yeah.
And which means they can recognize how the sounds of each language was being made by the mouth.
Yeah. Fascinating.
That is astonishing. Aren't they amazing?
Obviously, it's impressive that any baby is able to do this. But what the team at Western Sydney University's results suggest is that they can do this at an even younger age than previously thought.
What we wanted to know is if babies can do high-level language-related abstractions before 6 months of age. Because so far, scientists have believed they cannot do this before they become specialized in the sounds in their native language, and we think they actually can do this.
Eylem's research suggests that at the tender age of just 4 months old, you were perhaps able to tell languages apart just by how the sounds in those languages were made. 4 months old, you was pretty smart.
Coo, coo, ca, ca.
Unfortunately, however, it's more or less all downhill from there, because all of that sensitivity that allows you to pick up on any language in the world starts to fade away. By the time you're 1 year old, you've started to specialize in the language or languages that you're actually going to speak. But by then, another almost miraculous process is underway. You're learning to talk.
We tend to underestimate, you know, how hard it is to actually learn to make the sounds. So recent research shows that kids understand some words as early as sort of 6 to 9 months. But they don't say words that early. And you know, it's partly because there's quite a lot of work to be done between understanding them and learning how to say them.
Right. It's all well and good being able to recognize what sounds are being made. But it's another thing altogether to comprehend that these sounds are words. To us, speech is a series of discrete units, words. But to a teeny tiny weeny baby with no concept of grammar, it's just a stream of sounds. When I say a sentence like the one I'm saying now, I don't actually put gaps between the words. We're programmed to hear gaps, but they're not actually there. So a baby has to work out where these notional gaps actually are to find out where one word ends and the next begins. And again, the methods the little geniuses use are amazing.
One of the ones that people talk about is what they call transitional probabilities. So they're actually doing sort of, they're computing the chances or the statistics of sounds going next to each other. So essentially you can tell or you can guess whether a word, whether two sounds are part of the same word on the basis of whether those sounds often occur together. And if they don't often occur together, then they probably are falling on, you know, either side of the word boundary. The common example people use is, you know, if the child hears something like pretty baby, bay and be often go together in the language because baby is a very common word. Tea and bay don't go together in the language. So that's probably where the word boundary is. So the child can tell that there's a boundary between pretty and baby because tea and bay don't go together in words and bay and be do.
What's so amazing about that is an observation by a baby that I couldn't have made. You know, the difference.
You could have done it because, I mean, the experiments are done on adults as well, and they can do it too. They don't realise they can do it until they're stuck in the experimental situation.
But sometimes babies do get this wrong. They put the boundaries in the wrong place. For example, have you ever noticed a child say something like nana when they mean banana, or pewter instead of computer? However, in these instances, you cannot fault their logic. They are saying the wrong things, but for all the right reasons. You see, babies are brilliant at picking up on patterns, and the English language has a special pattern to it, one that traces way back to its Germanic roots. Most English words have what's called a trochaic structure. A troche is a stressed sound followed by an unstressed sound. Basically, English words usually have their emphasis on the first syllable. Father, mother, baby, coffee. But that's not just the case for two-syllable words. Elephant, celery, microphone. The stress always on the first syllable. Little kiddies notice this pattern. And when a word doesn't follow it, that's when things go wrong.
Some words don't have stress on the first syllable. Often words which are not really English words or which have been imported into the language from somewhere else. So, for example, banana has stress on the middle syllable. That's one of the reasons why children say nana instead of banana, because they're basically changing the sound pattern of banana, or they're fitting banana to the sound patterns that they know.
Isn't that fascinating? So this rule of English, inherent to the languages brought over to Britain by the Angles and Saxons over 1,000 years ago, is still influencing how babies learn to speak today. Once a baby's been able to establish that a word is a word, then they can start to work on using it by mimicking the way other people, like their parents, say it, as we discussed earlier. And then eventually, once they've got enough words in their adorable little back pockets, Julian says 50 to 100 is about right, then it's time to start putting them together. They'll start saying things like, "Daddy, do it." And all of a sudden, they're constructing sentences. And what do sentences require? Grammar.
We know that 20-month-old English-speaking children already know that the order of the words in English tells you who's doing what to whom.
Right, if I say Rob eats the cake, that means something very different from the cake eats Rob. The words in the two sentences are exactly the same, but the order of them dictates the meaning. And kids know that before they're even 2 years old.
You can show them a film of a bunny doing something to a duck, some novel action to a duck, and a duck doing something to a bunny at the same time. And you can say, look, the bunny's gawping the duck. And if the child looks at the bunny doing something to the duck rather than the duck doing something to the bunny, then that tells you that they understand the word order. And they do at 20 months.
And from there, the linguistic sky is the limit. My own daughter, my real one, is 6 months old now, and I cannot wait to find out what her first word is going to be. Judging by how well she's getting on with the cat, I think there's a danger it might end up being meow. I've got to keep an eye out for that. But what a thing it is to consider that we all went through this process and that we were all at one point these tiny little linguistic geniuses. Thank you so much for watching. Thanks also to Julian Pine and Eylem Altuntas for their incredible insights. If you've enjoyed this video, consider checking out my Patreon perhaps, where I've got loads of extra stuff exclusive to members, or just watch this next. I'll see you over there. Take care.